Hi all, today we are going to discuss about working of three-phase induction motor. So we have seen in our last class, then when you are giving a supply which is displaced mechanically by 120 degrees and electrically also displaced by 120 degrees, a rotating magnetic field will be produced because of them. So the rotating magnetic field will rotate in the space in the same sequence as your supply, and the speed of rotation, so it will rotate at a speed of a synchronous speed. And let us assume this, there is a north pole here and a south pole is produced here. They will rotate with respect to the space, and the magnitude of the flux, the resultant flux we have seen there, this will be equal to 1.5 times of phi maximum into cos of theta minus omega t, where theta is the space angle in mechanical degrees and omega t is the electrical angle. And the second one we have seen in lecture number 202 of the AC circuits, that means basic electrical engineering lecture number 202, the synchronous speed will be equal to 120 f by p. There I have made the derivation. There we have seen that the electrical degrees will be equal to p by t times of the mechanical degrees in one revolution, or this I can write as 2 pi f is equal to p by 2 times of the mechanical degrees will be 2 pi into n divided by 60. So, or from this I can calculate this one. So, ns will be equal to 120 f by p. This n is nothing but the synchronous speed, which is given by 120 f by p. Okay, now the poles are running in the clockwise direction. The north pole and south pole are running in the clockwise direction. We have seen in the case of DC machines, the poles are stationary, the conductors are rotating. And then in order to find the direction of the EMF, we have applied the Fleming's right hand rule. I think you remember that one. So we can tell that the Fleming's right hand rule can be applied by taking the direction of rotation of the conductor as the direction of the conductor with respect to the direction of the field. That means with respect to the field, what is the direction of rotation of the conductor? Agree with me? So based on that only we can find the direction of the EMF induced. So here the conductors are stationary, the field is rotating in clockwise direction, or with respect to a field, let us assume a person is sitting on the field which is rotating at the speed ns. It is like a person sitting inside a train. A person that is standing outside will assume to be a person who is sitting in the train. In view of him, the person who is outside is moving in the backside direction, or with respect to the rotating field, so the conductors are rotating in this opposite direction. You agree with me? So that means with respect to this, the conductors can be visualized as rotating in the counterclockwise direction. So now you can apply your Fleming's right hand rule. Fleming's right hand rule, if this is your direction of the field, this is your direction of the field, because there is a north pole here, there is a south pole here, and the conductor is kept here. So this conductor or the rotor, so this is rotating in this direction. Thus you apply the Fleming's right hand rule. The pointing finger is pointing downwards, and your thumb indicates the direction of motion of the conductor. Your thumb indicates the direction of motion of the conductor. Then your middle finger indicates the direction of the current. So what will be the direction of current on the top conductor? You will get it as a dot. You agree with me? So we can tell the conductors that is lying below this north pole will have the dot induced in them. Agree with me? And the conductors which are in the south pole will have the cross in them. That means the EMF will be cross in them. Agree with me? So half of this there is a dot, and the remaining half there is a cross. Agree with me? So now this is just equivalent to a current carrying conductor is kept in a magnetic field. A current carrying conductor is kept in a magnetic field, it will experience as a force. So the production of the force can be explained using the two theorems. One is using the Fleming's left hand rule, and the second one using the interaction of force between two current carrying conductors, or interaction of the force due to two fields kept side by side. So what will be the force experienced by them? So let us see one by one of them. So now the current carrying conductor is carrying the current outwards. Apply your Fleming's left hand rule. So your middle finger indicates the direction of the current, and your forefinger indicates the direction of the field. Field is from top to bottom. Then your thumb indicates the direction of the force. So if you apply the force here, you will get the force on this conductor is like this. Again, the force on this conductor is like this. So because of this force, what happens? Your rotor will start rotating in the same direction as your rotating magnetic field. So as it starts picking up the speed, the relative speed between the stator and the rotor will be decreased. because the EMF is induced in the conductor due to the relative speed of the rotor conductor with respect to stator rotating magnetic field. Now the relative speed is decreased, so automatically the EMF will goes on decreasing, and it will go on decreasing up to the extent where the torque or the power that is transmitted to the rotor will be exactly sufficient to compensate for the rotor losses plus the mechanical load that is connected to your rotor. This is one way of analysis. The second way of analysis is from the magnetic field point of view. So the direction of, because we have seen in the first lecture of the rotating machines, that whenever two adjacent conductors are carrying current in opposite direction, a pole will be found between them. So that can be found by using right hand thumb rule. Apply your right hand thumb rule. If your curled finger are indicating the direction of the current, then your thumb indicates the direction of the magnetic field. So if you apply that, you will get your direction of the magnetic field here. Your direction of the magnetic field will be like this. So this will be the north pole of your rotor, and this is the south pole of your rotor. Getting it? This is the north pole of your rotor, this is the south pole of your rotor. And coming to the stator, this is the north pole and this is the south pole. Or this can be visualized like this. So the stator flux, if I am taking as my reference, this is my phi 1. Let us assume the stator flux I am taking as a reference. So with respect to the stator flux, the rotor flux will be, because the EMF induced in the rotor, because we have seen in the transformer also, because here also the EMF is induced because of the induction. So the same thing will be applicable here. The EMF will be induced behind this flux by some angle 90 degrees. And now this is my value of the current that is passing through the rotor. So this will be lagging behind this EMF some by angle theta 2, because it is lagging. The reason is the rotor is not pure resistive, rotor will have the inductance also. So that's why the current will lag behind this EMF by some angle theta 2. So accordingly the rotor flux phi 2 is produced, or phi r is produced. So due to interaction of these two fluxes, a torque will be produced. So this angle will be equal to 90 plus theta 2, agree with me? So the force between these two conductors, or the torque, is directly proportional to the fluxes. That means phi 1, that means stator flux, rotor flux, and the sine of the angle between them. Sine of the angle between these two fluxes will be 90 plus theta 2. Or we can tell the torque is proportional to phi 1 phi 2 into cos theta 2. Because of this, the torque will be produced, and the rotating magnetic field or the rotor will try to continue in the same direction of the rotor. So similar way, I can calculate my EMF that is generated in the rotor. So EMF equation will be similar to that of the transformer. I am not deriving here because for the first year level, because I need not go into this much deep concept. If you want the details, you can refer to my electrical machines playlist. So there I have completely explained all these equations and other things. You can please refer there. Here I am just discussing only the equation, then I discuss the remaining. 4.44, let us assume the number of rotor conductors that I am representing by N phase into number of rotor turns per phase in the rotor, multiplied by the flux, because EMF is induced because of the flux produced by the stator, phi 1. This will be multiplied with the frequency of the EMF induced in the rotor. This will be multiplied by the winding factor of the rotor. This is called as winding factor of rotor. Getting it? So this is number of turns per phase of rotor. And phi 1 is the stator flux, and f is frequency of rotor induced EMF, or what is the relative frequency of the rotor with respect to the stator. So let us see how to calculate this one. So I have told you that the stator is rotating at a speed of ns, but the rotor will rotate only at a speed of n. So I told you that this n will never achieve ns, because the reason is, if this n approaches to ns, then the relative speed between these two becomes 0. When the relative speed is equal to 0, the automatically, because the dynamical induced EMF is because of the interaction between these two, that means the conductor is cutting a magnetic field. If the relative speed between them is equal to 0, then there is no change of the field, automatically the EMF becomes equal to 0. That means n will never be equal to ns, because when n is equal to ns, the EMF becomes 0, torque becomes 0, and the rotor will fall back or stop. So the difference of the speed between the stator and the rotor, so that is given by ns minus n, this is equal to the slip speed. That means how much the rotor is slipping back the strata, that is given by ns minus n. So from this one term is defined, slip is equal to ns minus n divided by ns. This is called as per unit slip. Or in other ways, we can define the term n is equal to ns into 1 minus s. That means the speed of the rotor I can define by n is equal to ns into 1 minus s. So let us calculate what will be the frequency of the rotor induced EMF. So before that, your supply frequency can be written as ns into p by 120. This, you agree with me? This is the frequency of the stator. So the frequency of rotor can be, will be, it is depending on the relative speed between the stator and the rotor. Agree with me? So this will be ns minus n, because that is the relative speed, the speed multiplied by p multiplied by 120, because this n is the speed, relative speed between them. So this I can divide and multiply with ns. So ns minus n divided by ns. So this I can again multiply with ns into p divided by 120. This ns into p by 120 is nothing but your supply frequency. This ns minus n divided by ns, I told you this will be equal to sf. So we can tell the frequency of rotor will be slip times the stator frequency, or slip times your supply frequency. And generally the value of the slip under full load conditions will be 2 to 8%. Or if your supply frequency is, let us take for example 50 Hz, the frequency of the rotor induced EMF will be only 1 to 4 Hz. So frequency will be very less in the rotor. Getting it? So I am just summarizing the working principle of the induction motor. In the induction motor, when the supply is given, a rotating magnetic field will be produced, because a north pole and south pole will be formed. So which is having a magnitude of 1.5 times of phi maximum, and it will rotate within the space at a speed of ns is equal to 120 f by p. So now if you are taking the rotor, the conductors are lying there, because of the relative speed between the stator and the rotor, because stator fields are rotating, or with respect to the stator fields, actually we can take that rotor conductors are rotating in counterclockwise direction. We know that whenever a conductor cuts the magnetic field, the EMF will be induced in them. So EMF is induced in them, we can find by using Fleming's right hand rule. So the EMF induced in these conductors, so now it is equivalent to a current carrying conductor is kept in a magnetic field, it will experience as a force as per Fleming's left hand rule, or as per the Lenz's law. So if you apply the force, so force will be in the same direction as your rotating magnetic field. So your rotor will start rotating in the same direction as the stator. So it will go on picking up the speed, but as it goes on picking up the speed, the EMF induced in the rotor will decrease, because the EMF induced in the rotor will depend on the relative speed between the stator and the rotor. Relative speed between the stator and the rotor. So as the relative speed is decreased, so automatically EMF decreases. When EMF decreases, the value of phi r decreases. When phi r decreases, the torque decreases. So it will reach a point where the torque that is produced will be exactly equal to the losses plus mechanical output. That means mechanical load that is connected to this motor. So up to that much level, this speed will goes on increasing. Let us assume if the load is very less, so mechanical output required will be zero. So if the load is not there, mechanical output is zero. So speed will achieve to certain extent that it will compensate for the losses only. If you are taking the ideal machine, then n will be equal to ns. But practically always there will be some losses. So that's why the speed will never be equal to ns. As the mechanical load on the motor is increasing, the speed will goes on decreasing, because the flux is depending on the ER and ER is depending on relative speed. So more the relative speed, more will be the value of ER, more will be the phi r, and more will be the torque that is produced. That means more will be energy conversion from electrical energy to mechanical energy. Getting it? So I hope the working principle of three phase induction motor is clear to you. I have only discussed what are the preliminary things that is required at the first year level, because analysis of the induction motor and synchronous motor are relatively complex. So if you want to know this in complete detail, you can refer to my electrical machines playlist. So there I have explained in complete details and derivation and reasons for each and every statement I have given in today's lecture. So if you still have any queries, you can leave your comments in the comment section below. I will answer to your queries from there. Thank you. Thank you very much.